Thank you. Let us pray. O God, who manifest your mighty power above all by pardoning and showing mercy, bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us, and make those hasting to attain your promises heirs to treasures of heaven. We ask this to our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns in the image of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Amos. Thus says the Lord, the God of hosts, woe to the complacent in Zion, lying upon beds of ivory, stretched comfortably on their couches. They eat lambs taken from the flock and calves from the stall, improvising to the music of the harp like David. They devise their own accompaniment. They drink wine from bowls and anoint themselves with the best oils. Yet they are not made ill by the collapse of Joseph. Therefore, now they shall be the first to go into exile, and their wanton revelry shall be done away with. The word of the Lord. Christ, that the blessed and only ruler will make manifest at the proper time. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, and whom no man and whom no human being has seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal power. Amen. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus said to the Pharisees, there was a rich man dressed in purple garments and fine linen, and dined sumptuously each day. And laying at his door was a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who would gladly have eaten his fill of the scraps that fell from the rich man's table. Dogs even used to come and lick his sores. When the poor man died, he was carried away by the angels to the bosom of Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. And from the nether world, where he was in torment, he raised his eyes and saw Abraham far off, and Lazarus at his side. And he cried out, Father Abraham, have pity on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am suffering torment in these flames. Abraham replied, My child, remember that you received what was good during your lifetime, while Lazarus likewise received what was bad. But now he is comforted here, whereas you are in torment. Moreover, between us and you a great chasm is established. Prevent anyone from crossing who might wish to go from our side to yours, or from your side to ours. He said, Then I beg your father, send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they too come to this place of torment. But Abraham replied, They have Moses and the prophets, let them listen to them. He said, Oh no, Father Abraham, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent. Then Abraham said, If they will not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded if someone should rise from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We ask all the boys and girls who are at CCD today just come up here, like when Chuck will be talking about a few things, come up. All the young people come up, all of you are at CCD today. We're going to talk about something simple here. Come and sit around here, so clean, and ready for you. See how sharp you are today this morning. Let's clap for Luca, who is really running out of the day. But this one, if you want to try what he's doing, right? Want to try it out next time? No? Nobody's brave enough. Oh, no. Okay, we'll try to get you there. I have a few things here that I want to show you. Who knows what this is, right? Anybody know what this is? Yes. It's a hammer. What is it used for? To hammer nails, to fix things in the house, right? Okay, hopefully don't use it yet, right? All that tells you what to do. If I wanted to use this to play some music, would I be able to do that? Huh? Somebody saying yes here. Would you really be able to do that if I wanted to play some music and sing like that? Would I really do that? It wouldn't, right? That's a function, right? You know, if I need to play music, I need a guitar, right? Something like that, right? Is that sure? Okay. Let me see. What about this? Who knows what this is? What's that? Toothbrush, right? If I wanted to use this as a microphone to speak up, would I do that? No. Would I do that? Would you do that? Yes or no? No, absolutely not. Okay. Right, I have something else. The last thing that I have here is in my ear, right? So I'm going to bring it out. And what is this?
Money!
Oh, this is here. No one money is, right? So if I wanted to just buy myself some gas and things like that, would I do that, right? Go to Disney World and do a lot of things, would I do that? You can see the smile on these kids' faces here. Right? If I had this and I wanted to get anything that I wanted, would I do that? Which is a lot. Yeah. Yes. Right. But if I wanted to go to heaven, do you think this would help me?
No.
Yeah, very smart. The lesson of today's gospel is, money can get you anything in this world that you want. It makes us happy. It makes us feel good when we have it secure. But it cannot buy our way to heaven. And heaven is the most important thing for each one of us. The parents will tell you, we need Jesus to help us do that. Right? So I'm going to speak to the others about a few things, but you just have to keep that in mind. Money is nice, and use it for everything, but it doesn't buy our way to heaven. We need to Jesus in our lives for that. And your parents are going to explain to you more about that. When you go home, I give them that as a homework, right? The readings that we hear today are about the rich man and Lazarus. Many of you know the story so well about the rich man and Lazarus. When I read the gospel story today, I asked myself a few questions. How many of you have seen the show Wheel of Fortunes? Wheel of Fortunes? What we hear in today's gospel is almost the reversal of fortune. That story that we know so well, the rich man and Lazarus, and how things turn around for them. And the moral of the story is only one. What happens to people in the kingdom, in heaven, really depends on what they do or not. That's the moral of the story. Everything that we do here prepares us for what heaven is going to be for each of us in our life. So we need to start now to journey with Jesus in our life. That's the moral of the story. And so what happens, there's an unwritten code in the readings today. It's not like Jesus and the people of the readings do not like people who have wealth, who have money. You know, when I read the readings, this was almost a third gospel. Jesus is speaking something about rich people. And I said to myself, does he have a problem with having money? Is it a problem if we work hard and we are smart in our savings and we do everything right, have a little money in the pocket? Just as they said, we need it in our lives. However, our monies and the resources that we have are not only used just for ourselves, but for the benefit of others, for the benefit, for the common good in our own lives. And so the story that we hear today is about some people who don't understand that. And that's what Jesus has a problem with in today's gospel. The first reading and the gospel reading are really talking about wealthy people.
who have everything for themselves. The first name is Amos. And he speaks about people who are complacent. They are drinking wine from bowls and having, you know, smearing themselves with all this oil. You can only imagine what happens after that. I can only take wine in a glass. What about wine in a bowl and, you know, sleeping down and all this? You can only imagine what happened. They are complacent. They are having everything for themselves. And the reading says to John Buster, they are not bothered. Or in one Bible reading it says, they are not made sick by the collapse of Joseph, who is just next door to them. It's the rich man hearing the gospel. He's dining sumptuously, he's having everything, vesting in papal garments, which at the time was very expensive clothing. And Lazarus is lying right at his door, and he does nothing. This is how he reacts when he gets up to heaven. He thinks things are the same. He's commanding God, you know, get that Lazarus down here to go and, you know, get me something to cool my tongue. He still thinks things are the same way. But in the kingdom come, there is a verse of faith. There is a verse of hope. And the gospel is telling us to start now, especially with these young ones. Start now in teaching them what is important in the journey of life, in the journey of our souls. Love God above all things, love our neighbor as ourselves. To see the poor, us, and reach out to them. That's the key message of today's gospel. Starting that now. Someone once told me that oftentimes these people that Jesus is speaking about, and there's just a few people who, you know, he always went out and died in the wealthy. He doesn't have a problem with the wealthy. Just a few Pharisees who he had a problem with, who planted their wealth and did nothing for others. And they were very religious people. And the key question was asking myself, how can you be so faithful and devoted in the temple? And when you step out, you act in a different way. How do you say we believe something, and then when we go out to church, we act in a different way? We abuse our spouse, we hate each other, we look the other way when somebody is called. It has to be that. That's what the scripture reading is all about. Someone once said to me that these people, that the wealthy that Jesus is speaking about, always have three kinds of excuses. Three, just the very name. The first one is, they often say, it's not my fault. It's not my fault that someone is poor. I have nothing to do with it. The other thing that they often say, there is nothing really that I can do. There's nothing I can do. They are poor, I don't know what to do. Or the third one, I didn't know about it. Has that sometimes come into your own life when you have met somebody who is in need? That's not my fault. They messed up their choices and everything, you just look the other way. Or there is nothing that I can do. Even when you know that you could do something, or you are falling short of doing something, or you blind, you shut them off, you're indifferent. That's not what we want to teach our children in the world in which we live. Jesus tells us to do different. Even though sometimes we may not want to really face people who are suffering, we have always side with those who are victims in our lives, those who are downtrodden, those who are disadvantaged. That is the DNA of what it means to follow Christ. It also asks of us sometimes to carry the cross. It's not easy when you find such people. Think about the times that you have met a homeless person and given him a lot of time. It's not often that you do that. A mentally challenged person, many times you want to step away, but they too need someone to go. The disciples of Christ are called to do that in our life. It's not an easy thing, but that's our duty. We have a social responsibility to the poor who are around us. I come from Africa and I always make comparisons every now. It's not so good, but I tend to do that because of where I grew up. And I always remember those scripture readings that say, to whom somebody has given so much, has been given so much, more will be demanded. And whenever I'm going back at home in the village, back at home in my country, I look around and I say, how blessed our children here are with the Lord that they have. And how people with less than even a dollar can survive with just nothing. And how it is our responsibility to do something to such people. Maybe by speaking up, maybe by acting or caring for someone else, not in Africa, but here, to show that kind of compassion and mercy that Jesus asks us to be. This is what is going to turn the world around. The best way they learn it is at home, when they see us help someone behind in finance, and you will help out the school teacher. They will learn what it means to be a pastor. We're going to cut short of our expenses today on toys, and we're going to give this, we're going to put it in a poor box for somebody who doesn't have anything. Then the change begins to get into their hearts, and they will be greater citizens of their community, of their society, and there will be people who see others not for what they're not, you know, compared to them, but what they can be in their lives. Do not think less of others, but think about how they can lift others. It's not easy, it's not something that you learn so quickly, but beginning at a young age is something that we can soak and learn in our lives. So let us pray that the good Lord will continue to inspire us with examples in our families, in our community, of one who reaches out to Lazarus. Because there's Lazarus around us. If you look, maybe it's even your spouse who's Lazarus. Maybe it's somebody in your family. There is Lazarus all over us. And we need to be a church, a community that stands up for Lazarus. Because in that way, we prepare for our way to heaven. In the Father, to the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Did I get you all sleeping? Let us stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father of all men, to make your heaven and earth. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from Jesus God, the Lord and Lord made, and consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things are made, for us men and for our salvation, we can come from heaven. We can come to the Virgin Mary, the beginning of heaven. For our sake was crucified and our conscious Father, he suffered death and was buried, and was laid in hell the third day, according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is the Lord and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess my baptism for the forgiveness of sins. Let us now lift up to the Lord some of our prayers and meditations. Let us pray.
Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer. For the church, that we may be a people of virtue and profess with both our words and deeds God's love for and presence within the human family, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all disciples of Jesus, that we may put on the mind of Christ and open the gates that isolate and protect us from all who are suffering or who disturb our complacency, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of our confirmation candidates who begin their year-long preparation this weekend, that their personal decision and commitment to follow Christ may grow to be firm and steady and bear fruit in their lives in words and deeds. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who live in complete poverty, for refugees, for the homeless, for those recovering from natural disasters, and for all the children orphaned by AIDS, that God will open new possibilities for them and open the eyes of the wealthy to see the needs that exist. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are seeking employment, that God will give them courage to persevere and help them to recognize new ways to use their gifts and talents. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For healing in our cities and neighborhoods, that the Spirit of God will free us from the shackles of all that obscures us from establishing true justice and promoting the common good. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of our deceased loved ones, may they rest in peace, and especially for our parish family, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And we ask for the intercessions of Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Our preparation of the gifts hymn is number 479, What Wondrous Love is This, number 479. And our communion hymn will be number 622, The Cry of the Poor. Our communion hymn is 622, The Cry of the Poor.
Oh, my soul.
now permitted that our sacrifice would be accepted with the God of the
The sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and the good of all this holy church.
Grant us, O merciful God, that these our offerings may find acceptance with you, and that through it the wellsprings of all blessings are laid open before us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is right and just our duty and our salvation. Always and everywhere give you thanks, Lord, for the Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For although you have not given our praise, yet our thanksgiving is itself a gift. Since our praises add nothing to your greatness, but profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord. So in the company of the angels in heaven, we praise you with joy as we acclaim. Therefore, I was
observe it in the memorial of his death and resurrection. We pray, Lord, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation. Giving thanks shall make us worthy in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ may be gathered into one by his Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spirit was well. Bring that the fullness of charity to Francis, our Pope, Robert, our Bishop, all the clergy. Remember the members, our brothers and sisters, who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, especially Laura, who remember this Mass, all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them now into the light of your grace. Have mercy on us, so we pray. The Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Apostles, St. Boniface, St. Joseph, all the saints who pleased you throughout the ages. May we merit to be coherent with eternal life, praise and glorify you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Do him with him in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. We now stand and pray with confidence, the Father, in the word of our Savior.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from the evil. Grant us peace in our families and in our days. With the help of your mercy, free us from sin. Save us from all distress. The way to blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our faults, but on the faith of the church. Grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
One another will offer a sign.
Thank you.
Let us stand and pray. May the heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body, that we may be coherent in the glory of Christ, whose suffering we are united whenever we proclaim his death, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
We have two announcements. Confirmation, parent, and candidate mass will be held at 6 p.m. on Sunday, September the 25th, followed by a meeting. Candidates and parents are expected to attend. Community cleanup day is October 15th from 12 noon to 3 p.m. Planning sheets are at the entrances of the church.
Let us say, you know, thanks to our young older sons, we need older sons, so tell your kids to brave up, you know, and come. The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Almighty God, bless us all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our masses end and remain in the peace of Christ.
Thank you.
Have a good week, everyone.